Vai ver o que eles estão fazendo no presente e descobrirá o que irá acontecer em um futuro próximo. Guns N' Roses, passado, presente e futuro. Sábado às 18h com reprises no domingo à 13h e às 22h. Adivinha? Na LTV.
Guns N' Roses' roots go all the way back to Indiana, home state of both Axl Rose and guitarist Izzy Stradlin. Unappreciated in his hometown, Rose eventually made his way to Los Angeles, where he hooked up with Stradlin again, and with an Anglo-American guitarist who called himself Slash. With bassist Duff McKagan and drummer Steven Adler rounding out the group, Guns N' Roses started scuffling on the L.A. club circuit, and in 1986 released their first record, an EP, on an independent label. A major label, Geffen Records, quickly snatched the group up, and in the summer of 1987 released the first Guns N' Roses album, Appetite for Destruction, which slowly climbed its way to the top of the pop charts and also spawned the group's first number one single, Sweet Child of Mine. Appetite for Destruction also yielded two other top 10 singles, Welcome to the Jungle, and Paradise City. In the summer of 1988, Guns N' Roses toured the country with Aerosmith. By the fall of that year, more than a year after the release of Appetite for Destruction, the group had only an EP's worth of new material ready for release. Packaged together with the tracks off the band's first independent EP, these songs appeared on the market under the name GNR Lies, an album that spawned another top 10 hit, the uncharacteristic ballad, Patience.
Said woman, take it slow, things will be just fine. You and I'll just use a little patience.
Beleaguered by drugs and other personal problems, Guns N' Roses kept a very low profile throughout most of 1989, allegedly trying to put another full album together. Then in September of that year, the band was called upon to open a series of concerts in Los Angeles by the Rolling Stones.
It was great playing with them. It was a definite dream. I mean, it was something that we told people we were going to do, and people were going, no, they're broke up. I don't care. We're going to open for the Stones. You wait. We're going to do this. I don't know how, but we're going to do this. So, and then, you know, I told Keith Richards that, and he's like, well, you made it, mate. Let me have a cigarette.
For more than a year after that, Guns N' Roses continued trying to complete their second album. Drummer Steven Adler had to be dismissed for drug abuse, and then in January of this year, with former Cult drummer Matt Sorum recruited to take Adler's place, and another new member, Dizzy Reed, added on keyboards and percussion, Guns N' Roses bounded back into the spotlight at Brazil's big Rock in Rio festival. Mr. Brownstone, he's been like it. Pumped up by the Rock in Rio experience, Guns N' Roses committed themselves to launch a tour on May 24th, by which time the group's long-delayed follow-up to the four-year-old Appetite album was expected to be ready for release. As that date drew near, the band mounted a trio of surprise warm-up dates at rock clubs in San Francisco, Los Angeles, and New York City.
New York was the best. San Francisco was a bit wobbly. I'm about to read a review on it. This is the first time Axl sang with us in 2 years, maybe. And L.A. was rock. And New York was the best.
By the time May 24th finally rolled around, the band's new album, or albums, since there were now to be two of them, still weren't ready for release. But Guns N' Roses, itching to get back on the road, launched their tour anyway.
I get up around 7, get out of bed around 9, and I don't worry about nothing, just want to waste about time.
By June, the two new Guns N' Roses albums, both called Use Your Illusion, were still 2 months away from release. Fans were appeased somewhat, however, by the release of a new single, a song off the soundtrack of Terminator 2 called You Could Be Mine. Over the course course of their current year-long tour, Guns N' Roses have lost another member, founding guitarist, songwriter, and singer Izzy Stradlin.
Izzy decided he wanted to leave and go do his own thing. And we had like 2 weeks to find somebody. So Slash and Duff and myself just started throwing around names, you know, and Gibby was an old friend from the club days, you know, in L.A. And we thought he was the perfect choice.
So I called him up, and he was the only guy that we physically auditioned.
I had 2 weeks to learn like 40 plus songs. 2 weeks. So it's like I didn't have any time to think about anything, you know. Izzy and I are from the same school. We all kind of like the same kind of music. So I think that's one of the things that the reason why I'm doing it is because there was a certain style that they wanted, and that was what I played.
Rounding out the live Guns N' Roses experience these days are backup singers, an all-female horn section, and utility player and singer Teddy Andreas, who previously worked with singer-songwriter Carole King.
We got a guy named Teddy Andreas, and he does harmonica, which is on songs like Bad Obsession, and he plays organ. He's a great organ player, and he's just a great background vocalist.
And it's fun having this, like, this whole, you know, entourage out in the road, you know, like five girls and Ted, and the rest of us, it's a circus, you know?
A circus indeed. With only 3 full albums to their credit, Guns N' Roses have already stirred up enough controversy to fuel a 20-year career. And while the band continues to grow and change, its members remain scruffy and stubborn and determinedly true to the musical beliefs that inspired them in the first place.
Artistic, you know, they're in their own world.
They don't care what anyone thinks. They don't care about anyone. They do their own thing.
They're kind of rebels, so, you know, we kind of dig them pretty much.
We totally idolize Slash as a guitarist. I have the same kind of guitar as Slash.
I love their attitude. I love Axl Rose. He's my idol. I want to grow up to be Axl Rose.
Why is Axl Rose awesome? Look at the guy. Just look at the guy.
The most notorious band in the world.
In the world.
Why
in the
world.
Worldwide. Worldwide.
And I have to usually somewhat keep it a bit controlled and stuff so things don't get crazy and stuff. But, you know, I was out signing autographs and talking to people tonight.
I've always been the one, you know, the type to take the time out to talk to people. It's like when it comes down to it, that's where we're happening.
With Guns N' Roses fans, there's a lot of Axl, you know, but it's like this is a band and I wouldn't be able to do what I do the way I do it and wouldn't be able to get the recognition if I didn't have the band I have. Being supportive and playing the music that they play that makes me run around and stuff. You know, we all pretty much get off on each other a lot. Right now we don't use a set list. We just pick song to song on how it feels and what we think we can perform best and what I think vocally I can do best.
Our shows, we never had a perfect show. And, you know, like a lot of bands, I won't say the names or whatever, they have like the set list and they say the same thing in between songs every night. That's like going to a 9-to-5 job for me.
Now I get up around whenever. I used to get up on time.
My first live show with Guns N' Roses was Rock in Rio.
What was that like?
It was like a blur. I was like, man, I can't believe this. You know, I mean, I would be like completely lying and ridiculous if I said I wasn't nervous for that.
Bad woman, take it slow, and things will work out fine.
We go out and it's real for us. It's like the first couple songs, we feel what the crowd's like. And it's not an easy thing to do to be able to, you can't fake it, you know? So we go out there and do it the way we do it.
When it comes down to it, I mean, we really are just a touring band, and that's what we're geared toward, and that's what we should be doing, and that's what we're gonna do. We'll be right back.
Having conquered the hard rock precincts of their native land, Guns N' Roses next set out to whip the rest of the world into line with its non-stop 3-hour live show. Nearing the start of its second year on the road, the band played a massive combination AIDS benefit and tribute concert near London for the late Freddie Mercury, frontman for one of Guns' all-time favorite bands, Queen.
The idea behind the whole concert, the fact that it was completely sold out before they knew who was on the bill, talking about the public, and it sold out the way it did, gave it a sort of certain kind of energy to the AIDS awareness thing, especially in the rock and roll circle, and losing Freddie to it was, you know, like a catastrophe, and it turned everybody's heads around. Having everybody show up at the concert for that cause was great, and then all the bands that were there, there was none of that sort of rock star, you know, who's who of rock vibe going on. So we all had a basically good time, and it was really well organized.
Following the Freddie Mercury tribute, Guns N' Roses set out to see the rest of Europe, from an opening date in Dublin to concerts in such formerly restricted areas as Hungary and Czechoslovakia, where the group performed in the historic capital city of Prague.
Prague, the crowd was great, and the people were very interested in the American culture and talking to us. They spoke English very well.
Claiming frustration at the fact that the band couldn't play for every fan who wanted to see it, Guns N' Roses scheduled a pay-per-view cable concert to be shot at the Hippodrome de Vincennes in Paris and broadcast to 14 countries. Special guests on the bill included members of Aerosmith, Guns buddy Lenny Kravitz, and legendary guitarist Jeff Beck.
I just got a phone call from my manager saying, Guns N' Roses called you. Would you care to step on stage and do a number with them? And I said, where? In Paris. I said, yep, let's go. But they told me Locomotive was the song, and it's pretty, it's a lot of changes in it.
Yeah.
I guess they thought that I'd be all right for that, for a guest spot.
Beck and the band roared through a rehearsal for the Paris show and may have overdone it. Beck, who suffers from a loud music-induced hearing disorder called tinnitus, had to bail out of the concert itself due to pain in his ears, leaving this rehearsal footage as the only suggestion of what might have been. Lenny Kravitz joined the band for a rendition of his own song, Always on the Run, a tune for which Slash composed the guitar riff.
It was a riff that I wrote initially. I mean, I write everything for Guns, you know, and sometimes, especially when Steve was in the band, you know, some stuff was definitely too funky. And so we just didn't use it, and I put it on the back burner. And so now, having Guns play it, I was like, you guys don't even realize how funny this is.
For a jam on the old Yardbirds classic Train Kept a Rollin', the band brought on singer Steven Tyler and guitarist Joe Perry of Aerosmith, a group for which Guns N' Roses had been an opening act only a few years earlier.
So they just showed up to watch Jeff play, you know, and then we just got everyone out there, and we had never really rehearsed it or anything, but it sounded cool.
Kind of a great position to be in, to be able to ask, you know, people like that, and they go, yeah, and they're into it, you know, they did it because they want to jam, you know.
Next up on the unending Guns itinerary was a co-headlining summer tour with the band's hard rock pals in Metallica, an outing that kicked off on July 17th in Washington, D.C.
I mean, basically, how we hooked up was that we both had the same lawyer back here in L.A. in like 87, 88, and hi, Peter, and he said to me, there's these guys in this new band called Guns N' Roses, this is before the record came out, before Appetite came out, there's these guys in L.A. that you got to hook up with because they have the same attitude, and you guys will get along with them really well. So we hooked up with Slash and stuff way before their first record came out.
You know, something very Spinal Tap about this song.
We're good friends with those guys and stuff, and we've got it worked out, so it's going to be it's going to be a cool thing for everybody. It's not going to be like Guns N' Roses is headlining and Metallica's opening. It's going to be you know, Metallica and Guns N' Roses. And, you know, they're going to do their full set, we're going to do our full set, and then who knows what will happen after the end of that. It'll probably be something cool.
With Metallica doing its normal three-hour show and Guns doing 3 hours plus an opening set by Faith No More, this was a show designed for hardcore rock addicts only.
And then play 3 hours, we would play just over 3 hours, so it'll start early.
In actual fact, just starting on time would be an accomplishment for this chronically tardy group.
On the tickets, we used to just write around 9.
Yeah, right.
You know, not at 9, around 9 somewhere. And that could be anywhere.
The first night that I played with them, you get your little sheet and it says, you know, set time, 9:30 and stuff. And I was already at 9:30 and stuff. You know, 11:30 comes around. So I learned quick.
I've learned to deal with it, and I can understand where Axel's coming from because he wants to give his best performance. And until he's ready, he doesn't feel up to it, he doesn't like to go on.
Despite the band's non-stop road work, the individual members of Guns N' Roses have managed to find time to work on solo projects.
I've been doing like one-offs with different people like crazy, and I've got a Stevie Wonder thing I'm doing, and I just did Carole King. Well, I didn't do Carole King. I did a song with her and the Michael Jackson stuff.
Duff McKagan recruited some of his bandmates, along with Lenny Kravitz and Skid Row's Sebastian Bach and Dave Sabo, to record an album that should demonstrate for all to see that he's much more than just a bass player.
I played drums on most of the tracks. Matt played on one of the tracks. And I played bass, obviously, and I played guitar. And I sing, sort of.
He's got a rock tune with a rap in the middle. And it's you gotta hear it. It's different, man. It's definitely Duff.
Aside from its members' various solo endeavors, Guns N' Roses also have another band project in the works.
We're making a movie. I can't really tell you too much about it because we're kind of sworn to secrecy a little bit, but it's a documentary. It's also, the videos will be intertwined, okay? If you notice some of our videos don't really make sense, they will. For me to really tell you everything would really kind of spoil the fun of the anticipation.
Yeah, I just see the cameras all over and stuff, and you know, after a while you just forget about them. So I don't know if it's going to be like the Madonna thing or anything. I hope not.
I pray for the guys that have to edit it, because there's a lot of stuff to take out, you know?
Like what?
Just stuff, you know, stuff that we don't want to have. Nothing bad, you know, nothing, as far as you know. Basically, right now, we're just trying to do the shows, and then when it's all said and done, we'll get together and start going through the video stuff and putting out the punk record and, you know, getting all that out of the way and then concentrating on the next album.
The Guns N' Roses punk album is actually a collection of covers recorded in true punk fashion.
Well, we recorded the epic Use Your Illusion 1 and 2 albums. Duff gave me a call and says, hey, let's do a punk record. I'm like, I was thinking of going maybe to Hawaii or something, but
no.
So we went in the studio one day and we did a bunch of covers, about 4 or 5 songs. New Rose and a song by Fear, which I can't say the title on the air.
Yeah.
And a bunch of stuff.
Shed a tear, 'cause I'm missing you. I'm still all right to smile.
Given all the activity in their various lives, a fan might well wonder when they'll ever find time to write material for their next album.
When we do have a chance to sound check, usually what we try to, like, we just jam, you know, come up with riffs. So we got some good stuff going, yeah. We tell the sound man to hit the tape player, and then later on we compile some of it and maybe have another Guns N' Roses album in 5 years.
We haven't gotten together as a band, per se, and, like, started to put songs together. Although we've been jamming a lot, you know, because we always jam. And so I sit around and, you know, come up with ideas, and I just keep them in my head, And when, you know, everything's over with, we'll probably get together and start trying to culminate some of the ideas.
Yeah. This band writes the kind of songs it wants to write. I mean, you know, our A&R guy is cool, and he works with us, but he's not, like, saying, hey, you gotta do this and do this. It's mainly what we feel, you know, and acting with school lyrics. I mean, he doesn't, obviously, from some of his lyrics, you know, it's like, someone's not going, hey, you can't do that, you know.
So I have responsibilities to myself and to the music and things I want to do with it, like, you know, trying to relate to as many people and help open their minds up and at least make them think. I'm not telling them we can save the world, but I can kind of describe the world and, you know, and just at least let them think about it, you know.
Really, we've only just begun. We've only have, what we have, what, 4 records out. You know, we're still babies, you know. We've got a lot to achieve.
Writing music and songs is the most important part of it to me. Everything else is, like I said, is a benefit, and we're really glad to get those, and we want all those we can get. But at the same time, if we have to really compromise on the music, then it's really not worth it in the long run.